بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله وكفى والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على سيد الرسل وخاتم الانبياء وعلى اله الاسكياء واصحابه الاتقياء اما بعد ان شاء الله today we are covering from page 92 and 93 واما الاذن as for the ear. So last week's class we started off the second half of the book of Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi alayh, in which he is talking about the importance of refraining from sins. The first half of the book, he talked about the importance of obedience, and he taught us how to live a 24-hour day in obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from last week, the second part of the book, he's talking about now how to stay away from disobedience. And Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi alayhi taught us a very important principle, which is one of the pillars of the deen when it comes to conducting oneself and making decisions, certain decisions in life. And that principle is that دَفْعُ الْمَضَرَّ أَوْلَى مِنْ جَلْبِ الْمَنْفَعَ, that it is more important to save yourself from harm than to pull good towards your way. Right? It's more important to save yourself from harm. That's more important than to pull good towards your way. And this is what Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi said. If you recall, last week we talked about this, two different ways, two different opinions that existed, that some say it's harder to stay away from disobedience, while some say it's harder to engage in obedience, right? And both opinions were discussed last week with detail from their perspectives. So today Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi, when he's talking about the importance of saving yourself from disobedience, what he's talking about here, what he's mentioning is that he mentions there are seven body parts of the human being which are commonly used to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he listed each of the seven. He said, هي العين, the eyes, والأذن, ears, اللسان, the tongue, البطن, the stomach, الفرج, the private area, واليد, the hand, والرجل, and the feet. He said, these seven body parts of the human being are commonly used to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi is doing now, he's covering each of these seven body parts. He first tells us how we should use them, and then he tells us how not to use them. So as I mentioned last week again, that many scholars tell us how not to use certain body parts. We should lower our gaze, not swear, but sometimes we fail to mention how they should be used. So one thing beautiful here that Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi does is that first he tells us how we should use these body parts. Either at the beginning or the end of that particular discussion, he mentions it. That you should use this body part in this way, and at the same time be careful not to use it in this and this way. So last week we discussed the first point, which was أَمَّ الْعَيْنِ, the eye. And Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi told us what we should use it for and which things we should not use it for. Today we move to the second thing, وَأَمَّ الْأُذُنُ, the ear. Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi says, وَأَمَّ الْأُذُنُ فَاحْفَظْهَا عَلَىٰ أَن تُسْغِيَ بِهَا إِلَىٰ الْبِدْعَةِ أَوِ الْغِيبَةِ أَوِ الْفُحْشِ أَوِ الْخَوْضِ فِي الْبَاطِلِ أَوْ ذِكْرِ مَسَاوِئِ النَّاسِ فَإِنَّمَا خُلِقَتْ لَكَ لِتَسْمَعَ بِهَا كَلَامَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى وَسُنَّةَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَحِكْمَةَ أَوْلِيَائِهِ وَتَتَوَصَّلْ بِهَا إِلَى إِسْتِفَادَةِ الْعِلْمِ لِتَنَالَ بِهَا الْمُلْكُ الْمُقِيمُ وَالنَّعِيمَ الدَّائِمُ. So what Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi says here is that be careful, protect yourself from listening to those things which are considered bid'ah. Do not sit in gatherings of bid'ah, in which innovations are being discussed, in gatherings in which things are taking place that are against the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the teachings of the Quran. Stay away from those gatherings. Don't even listen to those gatherings, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us that sometimes, actually before we go to the hadith, sometimes when you're listening to someone who's talking about something that is against the deen, for you to sit there silently even, and to engage in those gatherings, and give that person an ear to listen to them, right? It could show that that person may take that as a platform to claim that what I'm saying is right. And that person may feel that they're being honored. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us in the hadith, مَنْ وَقَّرَ صَاحِبَ بِدْعَةٍ فَقَدْ أَعَانَ عَلَىٰ هَدْمِ الْإِسْلَامِ. The one who honors the man who innovates in the deen, that person has helped in destroying the foundation of the faith. What is this doing, this person? He's helping in dropping and toppling this big imara and this big, you know, this big building that Islam is. This person is assisting in toppling it over. Because bid'ah is the complete opposite of hidayah, the guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent the Quran and the Sunnah. The opposite of the Quran and the Sunnah is bid'ah, innovation in the religion. Okay? Now one thing is that it's okay to listen to a person if you feel that by listening to them, that person may feel closer to you because you've given them an ear. And then later on, over a period of time, you can try to talk some sense into them or try to reason with them. That's another thing. You're listening to them with the intention of da'wah. That's one thing. We're talking about listening in agreement or listening out of honor and respect of that person. So here Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi says, make sure you do not sit in gatherings in which bid'ah is being discussed. The second thing he says is ghibah. Ghibah means backbiting. Do not even listen, do not even give an ear to someone who's backbiting, because if there's no ear to listen to the one who's backbiting, then the one who's backbiting will also stop. Right? If I have no one to listen to me, will I talk about it? If I'm sitting with 10 friends and I start talking about a particular person, that mufti sahab and that scholar, you know, and I start backbiting that person, if the friends in the gathering say to me that you need to stop talking about that person, it doesn't matter how evil, how corrupted, how big of a crook that person is, it's not permissible for you to backbite that person. Stop right now. If someone says that to this person 3 times in 1 week, do you think that person will have the courage again to backbite? Most of us would stop, right? We'd say, okay, you know what, I'm not going to do it again. I'll stop. I won't continue. But if we give an ear to someone to backbite, then what happens is it becomes problematic. That person then won't stop and they'll continue. This becomes a problem where sometimes, for example, your mother may be speaking to you over the phone and she'll be talking about someone else. Now, with all due respect, that's your mother. But at the same time, she's engaging in something which is prohibited in the religion. Now you have to make a decision. Either you respectfully tell your mother, "Mother, I have to put the phone down, I have to go somewhere," you kind of dodge the discussion. Or you respectfully again, you say to your mother that, "Mother, this is not permitted in the deen, it's probably good that we talk about something else. It's probably good we talk about. Let's talk about what you cooked today. Let's talk about, you know, what I'm going to eat when I come home today." Or we change the discussion in some way or the other. Okay? Now, at that particular moment, it may be very hard for your mother to bear that you shunned her, or you kind of just give her a stiff arm. It may be very hard for her to believe that. But the reality is that you're saving her from entering into the fire of hell. And the other way around, sometimes you may be speaking to your father, and your father may be talking about someone that they shouldn't be talking about in that manner. It doesn't matter if you have a fight with your brother or your cousin, there's no need for you to do ghibat and backbite that person for 2 hours later on the phone. It's not jaiz, it's not permissible, and that's as simple as it gets. The deen has not permitted that. If you're informing someone because there's a benefit in them, for example, one of your family members cheated you, they took some of your money, and now you know that one of your relatives may be dealing with this person, not for you to tell this person is okay because you're telling that person why? So they can save themselves. But if you're just randomly calling your cousin and say, you know, oh, that person did this, that person did that, and they harmed me in this way, and they did this, and we said that, and you start talking about two men, what I said and what they said, then this becomes ghibah, and it's not permissible in the deen, right? And then some people say, but what I'm saying is true. What do they say? What I'm saying is, it's true, I'm not lying. Imam Ghazali, rahmatullahi alayhi, he actually discusses ghibah with some detail, and he says that ghibah is when you talk about something that is true in the person. If you mention something that is not true in that person, then there's two sins. Ghiba, backbiting, coupled with slandering. What are you doing now? It's tuhma plus ghiba. You're slandering that person, and you are also backbiting that person. So we have to keep in mind that we should be careful when it comes to speaking about other people. We should control our tongue and not speak. And for the one who's listening, because we're talking about the ear here, we're not talking about the tongue. The tongue is point number 3. As for the ear, we need to make sure that we do not even give our ear to someone that's backbiting. It may be harsh for that person at that particular time. But as I mentioned, ultimately that person will respect you for it, inshallah and aziz. Allah will reward you for it, inshallah and aziz. And you will be saving that person from entering into the fire of hell. The third thing the Prophet, here Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi alayhi mentions, he says, "Awil fuhshi," also save your ear from hearing anything immoral. You know when you're sitting with your friends and one of your friends cracks a joke that's not appropriate and you smile back? You know what you're actually doing by smiling back at that joke? You're asking him, please say another one. When a person cracks a joke, right? If you don't smile, if you don't entertain that person's joke, then you know what happens? They go quiet. They don't say another joke. Because they feel that, you know, that their joke was too dry, and it's probably best to keep it quiet. But when you smile, smirk, laugh, or kind of just even show some sort of, you know, consent of that joke, then they'll take the next step and say the next joke. And say the next step and say the next joke. And if they're talking about something immoral, then usually, you know, the standard is that when you say one joke, you only will say another joke if it's better than your previous. And then the third joke you say has to be better than the second one. And the fourth joke you say has to be better than the third one. So usually, 2 or 3 minutes or 10 minutes into your joke session, the jokes are now way below the belt. It may have started off with a little immorality in there, but 10, 15 minutes or even 5 minutes into your joke session, now you're talking about things that are completely not, you know, they're intolerant. You can't tolerate those things. You shouldn't be hearing those things. So we have to keep in mind that it's important that we do not even give our ear to an individual who was talking about immoral things, right? Whether it's in a joke, whether it's serious. Many times we tolerate immoral discussion because it's a joke. One sister will say something to another sister. One college brother will say something to another college brother. One high school kid will say something to another high school kid. It's a joke, so we just, you know, this word joking, right? It's so beautiful because this concept of joking allows a person to even hear the most foul things sometimes and be able to tolerate them. You know, someone can talk about Allah Azza wa Jalla and make a joke, and you'll tolerate it. Because why? It was a joke. But if that person said the very same thing without joking, you'd be standing on that person's chest, ready to smack him, right? So you have to understand whether someone's joking or not, the content of their discussion is what we have to focus on, right? We have to focus on the content of the discussion. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told the companions, right, that even when I joke, I speak the haq, I speak the truth. Because a Nabi will speak the truth no matter wherever he is, he won't lie. Even when he's joking, he will not lie. He cannot speak any falsehood. So even when we're sitting with amongst one another, we should not tolerate, you know, when it comes to immoral discussion. Zero tolerance. We shouldn't listen to it at all. And if it's serious, and if someone's seriously talking outside jokes, then that's even a bigger problem. Then there should be no, you know, you shouldn't tolerate to any level at all, and you should speak out against that person and tell them, as the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is there, man ra'a minkum munkaran falyughayyirhu biyadihi. Right? Whoever sees something wrong in the community, how should he try to stop it first? With his hands. Wa illam yastati' fa bilisanihi, and if not with his hands, then with his tongue. Wa illam yastati' fa biqalbihi, and if he can't stop it with his tongue, then at least with his heart. وَذَٰلِكَ أَضْعَفُ الْإِيمَانِ, and this is the lowest point of the faith, that you can't speak or do something for the deen. That's the weakest point of your faith, that you can't speak even for your deen. You have to hide it and keep it concealed in your heart. Sometimes you'll have to do that. But at that point, you need to turn away and get up and leave the gathering. Then Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi says, وَالْخَوْضِ فِي الْبَاطِلِ, and also do not give your ear to a person who's talking about false things, wrong things. For example, how to rob a bank. Or for example, how to oppress someone. Or for example, how to cause pain to another person. So don't even give that person your ear, because they're planning bad, they're planning evil, and you shouldn't listen to that person. Then he says, أَوْ ذِكْرِ مَسَاوِئِ النَّاسِ, or talking about the faults of other people. He says, فَإِنَّمَا خُلِقَتْ لَكَ لِتَسْمَعَ بِهَا كَلَامَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you this ear so you can listen to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you can listen to the Quran. The reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave these ears is so that we can listen to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can listen to the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But how sad is it that at times a whole week will pass by and not one harf of the Quran will go inside this ear? That happens. That sometimes an entire month will pass by and not one harf of the Quran will go inside the ear. And some of us may be very proud that, no, alhamdulillah, I pray salah 5 times a day, I listen to Quran. Had the fard of salah not been there, had the recitation in salah not been there, then Allah have rahmah on this ummah. Even Allah knows how many people here can say that I actually listen and read the Quran on a daily basis, the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us these ears to listen to the kalam of Allah, number one. Number two, so we can listen to the sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This in itself is a form of worship. Sitting down and listening to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I recall one time a person came to our teacher, Sheikh Bilal, and he said to him that, Maulana sahab, Sheikh sahab, only if I was alive at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I would have sat in front of him all day and just listened to his hadith. What did he say? I would have sat in front of him all day and just listened to him speak. That's what I would have done all my life. So our teacher said to him, the only way you can prove yourself to be truthful in that statement is by answering me, how much time of your day do you give to read the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Because the sunnah didn't leave us, did it? Do we still have the sunnah or not?
Yes.
Of course we do. Do we still have the hadith or not?
Yes.
Of course we have the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if we don't spare any time to listen to ta'aleem or listen to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then Allah knows where we would be had we been alive at the time of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inshallah we can hope for the best if we were alive at that time, you know. But the point that I'm making here is that we should dedicate a portion of our day to listen to the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When we were students in madrasa, especially in the final year of our alim course, every single morning from 8 a.m. until 8 p.m., maybe with a 1 hour break for lunch, a 1 hour break for tea at 4 o'clock, the other 10 hours, all we heard was qala Rasulullah, qala Rasulullah, qala Rasulullah, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. And our teacher said to us, he said to us that this year of your life, when you're studying Siha Sitta, Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, you know, Jami', Tirmidhi, Sunan Abi Dawud, Sunan Nasa'i, Sunan Ibn Majah, these books of hadith, you know, Muwatta Imam Malik, and all these great books of hadith that you're studying in this year, our teacher said to us that you'll never get the chance again in your life to listen to so much hadith in 1 year. That year, this year will never come back in your life. This is what he said, and wallahi, he was true. And our teacher, he said to us, he took this a step forward. And he said, this is a chance in your life to become a sahabi. What did he say? He said, this is the year in your life to become a sahabi, because this is what the sahaba did for the day of their life, for all the days in their lives. They sat in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would narrate these beautiful words and teach them their deen. So we should spend our year in learning the deen, right? And it's actually very beautiful that he mentions this, is because today there's a whole trend of audiobooks. Right? For those people who can't read or who can't dedicate time to reading, we have the phenomenon of an iPod. We have MP3 players. We have CD players. We have cassettes in our cars. Who can claim that they don't have time to listen to the deen? Who can claim that? The other day, one person came to me and he said to me, Mufti Sahab, you know, I can't attend your lecture, the Darul Hikmah classes that I teach on Saturday. He said, I'd love to attend the Darul Hikmah classes because I've always wanted to study the Seerah, but I just can't study it. I don't have the chance to study it. Saturday morning I'm busy, in the weekdays I'm busy, I don't have time, and I don't have time to read either. You know, make dua that Allah gives me the tawfiq one day. I said, Allah will give you the tawfiq if you make an effort. And I'm not even asking you to come to those classes, that's asking too much from you. What I'm telling you is that you can go on the internet, and as for myself, all of my seerah lectures have been recorded and preserved on salihin.com. Allah reward Brother Mazin and grant his mother a high place in Jannah. She recently passed away. We keep her in our du'as, inshallah, and aziz. And also his father-in-law recently passed away. We also make du'a maghfirah for him. Allah gives him Jannah, inshallah, and aziz. You know, all those recordings are preserved there. I got a phone call one day from a brother, and he said to me, that is your name Mufti Hussein? I said, yes, Hussein Kamani, I'm speaking. And this was a foreign number. And most foreign countries, that I get phone calls from, I recognize the country code. So I'm looking at it, I say, I don't recognize this country code. And I said, yes, brother, how can I help you? So he said, I'm calling you from Bosnia. I said, what? Why are you calling me from Bosnia? I don't have any relatives there. I've never visited Bosnia in my life. The only Bosnians I know are the beautiful people who sit in this gathering. But beyond that, there's no one else that I know from the Bosnian community. So he said to me that I've been listening to your lectures for almost a year now. And he said that I never had love for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until I heard the Seerah series. He said, after I heard the Seerah series, he goes, anytime anyone says the name of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I begin to cry. And it's not because of our lecture. There's nothing that I did in this. I don't attribute any of this to myself. What I attribute all of this to is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if we don't give our ear the opportunity to listen to the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how do we ever expect ourselves to change? Do you understand? So I was at the store the other day, at this Iqra bookstore on Divan Avenue, and I went there and they actually had a whole section dedicated to audio. A whole section. So many beautiful topics there, seerahs there. They had seerah lecture series by Brother Abdul Malik Mujahid in English, and they had one in Urdu by this Makki Hijazi Sahib, which is also a very beautiful series of seerah that he's done. I believe it's almost 60 lectures or something. It's a lot of detail he goes into, and so many different, you know, Sheikh Hamza Yusuf had so many lectures, CDs there, and one can actually, honestly, I'm being truthful to you, you can learn a lot of the deen if you're willing to give your ear. The average person sitting in this gathering probably spends easily 1 to 2 hours traveling per day. Is that right or wrong? Am I exaggerating or not? And if you're going to downtown, you can make that 2 to 3 hours easily, minimum. And if it's not in downtown, even the person who goes to work and comes back, we spend probably easily 1 hour a day inside the car. And if we have audio there, why don't we use that to listen to the deen? Why is it that we have to turn on WBEZ every single time? And even though there's a pledge drive going on, we still prefer to listen to that pledge drive rather than listening to what the deen has to say, what Quran is being recited, or the translation of the Quran, whatever it is. If we give an ear to the deen, watch how much we'll learn in our lives, inshallah al aziz. I had one friend, he became Muslim 1.5 years ago. How long ago? From now. He became Muslim 1.5 years ago. And he's from a place called Racine. Have you guys ever heard of Racine? Right? Some of you may have heard of it, some of you may have not heard of it. To be honest with you, there really isn't any particular representation of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah in that place. The only masjid that's there belongs to the Nation of Islam, right? And even there's no activity happening there at all. This brother became Muslim, he called me, he said, what can I do? I said to him, look, it wouldn't be practical for me to tell you to come to Chicago and learn here, and neither is there any nearby community, you know, and you know, transportation will also be difficult for this person. I said, if you have the internet, I will guide you to certain sites, listen to audios from there, and that'll help you. I met him 1.5 years later, 2 weeks ago, at Darul Hikmah. I said, what are you doing here? He said, I've made my mind up that along with your advice, I'm gonna travel from Wisconsin every Saturday to take your classes. I said, Allah give you barakah, right? And every week he's coming, mashallah. But when I was sitting with him, while we were discussing and talking, he started speaking, you know, in a very academic and scholarly manner. I said, you know, where is this all coming from? You know, I have friends who are Muslims in our community, and they don't really have, you know, many people, it's very hard to have an intellectual discussion with them on Islamic matters. Most people, they're very, you know, entry level when it comes to their religion, knowledge in the religion. And he was speaking very well, and I was very, you know, amazed. I said to him, where did you learn all of this? So he said to me, Mufti Sahab, you know, 1.5 years ago, you told me to listen to lectures. He goes, I've listened to every lecture on that website 3 times already. Every lecture on that website, how many times have I listened to it? 3 times I listened to each lecture. He goes, you want to talk about abortion? Let's go. He's telling me this. He goes, you want to talk about abortion? Let's go. You want to talk about zakat on 401k? Let's talk right now. I've listened to each lecture on that website 3 times already. Right? So what I'm trying to say, the point that Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi says here, we're still on the third line, that's give your ear to listening to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the third thing he says, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this ear so you can listen to the wisdom of the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? So the Quran, the Sunnah, and the wisdom of the awliya Allah, the close servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it says that so you can use this ear to gain the knowledge of the deen. And so in return, you may reach the eternal dominion of everlasting bounty. All this can come through gaining this knowledge and gaining this deen and listening. Just listening will help you so much in your life. Okay. Then he says, so if you use it to listen to something disliked, صَارَ مَا كَانَ لَكَ عَلَيْكَ Subhanallah. He says, then what was created for your favor will now come against you in your destruction. If you use this ear to displease Allah in those things that are disliked, that ear which was created for your favor will now lead you to your destruction. وَانْقَلَبَ مَا كَانَ سَبَبَ فَوْزِكَ فَصَارَ سَبَبَ هَلَاكِك He said, that which was made as a pathway for your success will now become the pathway to your halakik, again, your destruction. وَهَذَا غَايَةُ الْخُسْرَانِ And this is the ultimate loss. And he says, and do not think that the sin is only with the one who's speaking and not with the listener. For indeed, it is mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that indeed the one who listens to the one who is speaking is also one of the two people that is doing the ghibah. The one who is giving the ear to the one that is backbiting, the one who is listening is also amongst the person that is doing ghibah. He is also getting the sin of the ghibah too. This hadith is narrated by Imam Tabrani rahmatullahi alayhi. And now Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi alayhi moves forward. So we talked about the eye, we talked about the ear, and now we'll talk about the tongue. وَأَمَّا اللِّسَانِ, as for the tongue. فَإِنَّمَا خُلِقَ لَكَ لِتُكْثِرَ بِهِ ذِكْرَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى وَتِلَاوَةَ كِتَابِهِ وَتُرْشِدَ بِهَا خَلْقَ اللَّهِ إِلَىٰ طَرِيقِهِ وَتُظْهِرَ بِهِ مَا فِي ضَمِيرِكَ مِنْ حَاجَاتِ دِينِكَ وَدُنْيَاكَ فَإِذَا اسْتَعْمَلْتَهُ لِغَيْرِ مَا خُلِقَ فَقَدْ كَفَرْتَ بِنِعْمَةِ اللَّهِ وَهُوَ أَغْلَبُ أَعْضَائِكَ عَلَيْكَ وَعَلَى سَائِرِ الْخَلْقِ وَلَا يَكُبَّ النَّاسُ فِي النَّارِ عَلَى مَنَاخِرِهِمْ إِلَّا حَصَائِدُ أَلْسِنَتِهِمْ. Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi says, as for the tongue, it was created so you can engage in the dhikr of Allah and abundantly remember the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why this tongue was created. This tongue wasn't created to sleep on the palate. This tongue wasn't created to sleep there, just lie there. So you just khamush. The tongue was created for a purpose. There should be action. And that purpose, that movement should be to engage in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves most. You know, if you have a son, and your son just can't stop talking about you, how proud would you be? You know, if your son just couldn't stop talking about you, everywhere he went, he said, my father this, my father that, my father this, my father that. And even when he's sitting with his friends, he's talking about his father. When he goes to visit the scholar, he says, make dua for my father. When he goes to the haram, oh Allah, have mercy on my father. When he's after his tahajjud, he's saying, oh Allah, forgive my father. If he keeps talking about his father, he keeps remembering his father, and that father is to come to know, how will that father feel? Just proud, that's it. I mean, you'd be extremely happy, right? You'd be so happy, so happy, so happy that it's unbelievable. The same way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves to see His servant keep talking about Him, keep engaging in the remembrance of Allah. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes. You know, when the child is born, and the very first time the child says, Abba or Ammi, how happy does that parent get? Right? For those of you who haven't had children, it's an amazing feeling. My son said Abba the first time 3 days ago. And I just came to that experience right now. And it's such an amazing experience. I can never explain it in words. Muhammad just said it the other day. I was like, oh, mashallah. Yeah, Allah reward him. And you know, I made a lot of dua for him. Allah accept him for the deen too, inshallah. And Aziz grant him sincerity. Khair. So, the same way, when a servant displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a very long time, and he sins and sins and goes far away and far away, and then at some point when he turns back and he says, Allah, it's deeply loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves it a lot. You know, when a servant, when a child disobeys his father or his mother, or her father or her mother, and they get in a huge argument, and they don't talk to their parents for 15 days, or 3 weeks, or 4 weeks. That happens sometimes, right? The parents shout at the child gets angry, says, I'm not going to talk to you anymore. And he goes to the dorms, or she goes to the college, and they stop talking to their parents. And they don't talk to their parents for 1 month straight or 2 months straight. After 1 or 2 months, when you call your mother, when you decide to call her, when you call her, you know, you could ask your parents. When they just see your name on their caller ID, I can probably bet they're crying. Out of joy, they're crying that finally my son called. So imagine how happy Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must be when the servant disobeys Allah, disobeys Allah, disobeys Allah for so long, and then finally he calls Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by raising his hand in front of Allah. Imagine how happy Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must be that finally my servant came back to me. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves it when the servant comes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Each one of us sitting here has weaknesses. And we all know for a fact that if our weaknesses were to come in front of the eyes of the people, we would not be able to sit inside a masjid. If our sins had a stench, we would not be allowed to even exit our bedroom. That's how bad we would smell. And the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is such that He's hidden our sins from all of mankind. And His mercy is such that He's just waiting for each person, each one sitting here, to one day say, Allah, I'm sorry. And if you disobey Allah again, Allah will wait again for you to say, oh Allah, I'm sorry. And sometimes in our life, look, each person, each stage in your life as you advance, there are different struggles you have. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us with these struggles. We should try our best to stand against these struggles. For a kid, what's the biggest struggle for a young child? For a young kid who's maybe 4 years old, what's the biggest struggle? Dealing in interest. No, I'm joking. It's not dealing in interest, right? The biggest struggle for a four-year-old kid is to not eat candy. What's his biggest struggle? What's equivalent for him when he turns 21 years old, staying away from zina? Right, when he's 21 years old, the biggest trouble in his life is going to be staying away from zina. When he's 4 years old, what's the equivalent test for him? Candy. Don't eat candy. When he goes 6, 7 years old, now, don't lie. Do you understand? Now that's the big thing. Now when he goes 13, 14 years old, now it's about, don't swear. Okay. When he goes a little older than that, now, lower your gaze. When he goes a little further than that, now, earn halal. So every stage in your life, you'll have a new test. And every stage in your life, there's going to be a new test there. Right? Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put these tests in our lives so we can struggle to become better people. If there is no examination, if there is no test, if there is no difficulty, then how are we going to improve in our life? How are we going to become better people? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing us so we fall and stand up. Fall and stand up. Fall and stand up. We can't fall and stay down. We will always have difficulties in our lives. Trust me. There will always be difficulties in your life. And for some people, the difficulties will change, and for some people, the difficulties won't change. I've seen uncles who are sugar addicts at the age of 60, just as a four-year-old child is a sugar addict too. We've seen that, right? So for some people, it just doesn't change. It stays all the way through. And for some people, the addiction or the problems in life change. You have to keep in mind that you know what your task and what your hurdle in life is. You know it. I don't have to tell you, you don't have to tell me. There is no concept of confession in our religion. You only confess to who?
Allah.
Allah Azawajal. That's it. You don't have to confess to anyone else, right? Every person sitting here knows what their weakness is. Your wife may not even know of your weakness, and your husband may not even know of your weakness. That's how well you've hidden your sin. But you have to keep in mind, Allah Azawajal is aware. And you have to just say to Allah, Allah, I'm sorry. And trust me, if you continue to stay in that sin until you died, but you did not fail to say sorry to Allah, I can say wallah on this matter, inshallah, and I won't be wrong, you will find yourself in Jannah. Because this is what's promised to us by the Quran. What does the Quran tell us? What does the hadith tell us? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us, right, that in the hadith of Qudsi, where the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the message is coming from
Allah.
Allah Azawajal says in the Hadith Qudsi, لو أتيتني بأرض ال... Let me think of the words. لو أتيتني بأرض ال... There's a word there. خطايا. There's a word I'm missing. خير. Okay, لو أتيتني بملء الأرض خطايا لأتيتك بها مغفرة. That's the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? The hadith is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if the servant comes to me with a world full of sin, he will find that I will come back and return with a world full of maghfira and forgiveness from me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in another hadith of Qudsi, he says, right? لو أن أوله وآخره وإنسه وجنه قاموا في صعيد واحد فسألوني فأعطيت كل إنسان مسألته ما نقص ذلك من ملكي إلا كما ينقص المخيط إذا أدخل البحر. This is the words of the hadith, where the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the hadith of Qudsi that if all of my creation came to me, the first and the last, the insan and the jinnat, and they stood in one large plain, one large land, and all of them in one voice at one time in the millions of languages that may have existed throughout history and that will exist till the Day of Judgment, if all of them at the same time asked me for whatever they wanted inside their heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I will give them all what they want, and in return that will not decrease from my kingdom, even equivalent to a needle if dipped inside the sea, inside the ocean and pulled back out. You know, if you take a needle and you dip it inside the ocean, and you pull it back out, how much does it decrease from the ocean?
Nothing.
Do you have any idea how deep an ocean is? Do you have any idea how wide an ocean is? Do we have more water on this world or more land on this world?
More water,
right? All the water gathered together, and you take a needle, you stand in the middle of the ocean, and you dip it inside and pull it back out. How much is it going to decrease from the treasures of Allah? One drop? One drop probably? No. Because even that drop's going to fall back right back inside. The one drop that comes out, where is that going to go? Right back inside again. Not even one drop. This does not decrease anything from the kingdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if a person keeps coming back to Allah, keeps coming back to Allah, keeps coming back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to ask for forgiveness, whatever your struggle is in life, just have an intention that one day I will come over it. Have that intention. And keep saying sorry to Allah, keep saying astaghfirullah. And trust me, you will find yourself in Jannatul Firdaus, inshallah, Aziz. And you will find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be happy with you. Because not every person has the ability to be like Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi alayh, or Abdul Qadir Jilani rahmatullahi alayh, or above them the Sahaba radwanullahi ta'ala majma'in, or above them the Anbiya alayhim salatu wasalam, or above them like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. But one thing we can do, and no one can deny this one, is we can learn how to say sorry to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi alayhi says, spend your time in engaging in the dhikr of Allah. That's what you want to do. You want to try to engage in the dhikr of Allah as much as possible. Read the Quran as much as possible. These tongues have been abandoned from the words of Allah for too long. If you haven't let salah or read salah alone, the chances are you haven't opened the Quran for almost a week at least. Some people open the Quran every week for Surah Kahf. Some people open the Quran once a year for Ramadan. That's it. And the tongue is deprived. Do you know how bad this tongue must feel? It's like you're taking a fish and throwing it out of the water. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this tongue to read the Quran, and we've sat here depriving the tongue to read the Quran. So then he says, and the reason why Allah created your tongue is so you can guide people towards the truth. Call people towards the deen. Use your tongue for da'wah. That's why Allah gave it to you, for good purposes. Don't just, you know, people, we use this tongue to stop people from the deen, but we never use the tongue to call people towards the deen. We never do it. We'll use the tongue to stop people from deen, but we won't use this tongue to call people towards deen. This tongue should be used to call people towards deen. Use as many of your body parts as you can for the sake of the deen, because these body parts will speak on the Day of Judgment. Right? If you use your hands for good, these body parts will testify for you on the Day of Judgment. If you use your shoulders for good, these shoulders will testify for you on the Day of Judgment. If you use this back for good, this back will testify for you on the Day of Judgment. And my teacher would say that, look how sad it is. Every night when we go to sleep, we say we are tired. What do we say when we go to sleep? Every night before we go to sleep, what do we say? I'm exhausted, I'm tired, I'm really just burned out. And you ask that person, that brother or sister, why are you burned out? So you'll say, oh, I went to school today, I went to the gym, played basketball, was at the store all day, was driving a cab. You know, I did all these things and I'm tired. When is the time in your life that you've actually said that I'm actually tired and exhausted because I served Allah all day? This muscle in my body, it's actually sore right now. Why? Because I did khidmah of the deen. That's why this muscle in my body is sore. When's the last time that happened? That you say that, you know what, today my body is aching and today I'm really tired and exhausted because I worship Allah for that long. And I did this khidmat, and I helped that person, I helped this person. The body hasn't said that. It's as if we've never used our body. Our body, when it comes to serving the deen, is like a princess sitting in some sort of carrier. That's it. The body has never been used for the serving the deen. But when it comes to serving the dunya, when it comes to serving ourselves, then oh subhanAllah, this body has been exhausted and burnt and torn up. Right? You know, we can't even, we have arthritis now, and the body is going through so many different difficulties and pains because we've used it for everything other than worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah give us the tawfiq to use it for that sake. Then he says that if you use this tongue of yours for that thing which Allah did not create it for, that thing which Allah did not create it for, then you are being ungrateful to the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the most serious part in your body. What is he saying? This tongue of yours is the most important part in your body. It's a very serious, very delicate piece of meat that you have in your mouth. And then he says, وَعَلَى سَائِلِ الْخَلْقِ. It's not only severe on you, it's also severe on all of mankind. Your tongue is not only severe on you, it's also severe on all the other makhluk, all the other creation. And then he narrates the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, وَلَا يَكُبَّ النَّاسِ فِي النَّارَ عَلَى مَنَاخِرِهِمْ إِلَّا حَصَائِدُ أَلْسِنَتِهِمْ. People are not thrown into the hellfire on their faces for anything more than the harvest of their tongues. The hadith is narrated by Imam Tirmidhi. People will be flung in the fire of hell and they will land on their face because of what? Because of their tongue. Because of their tongue. Because they couldn't control this, that's where they will be in the hereafter. The Prophet ﷺ says in a hadith, مَنْ يَضْمَنْ لِي مَا بَيْنَ لِحْيَيْهِ وَمَا بَيْنَ فَخِذَيْهِ أَضْمَنْ لَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever can give me guarantee that which lies between his jaws and that which lies between his thighs, meaning his private area, I guarantee that person Jannah. You guarantee me two things, I guarantee you the third. You guarantee me your tongue and your private area, your private part, that you will take care of these two, and I guarantee you Jannah, inshallah, as he's in the hereafter. Let me just read a few more lines and we'll end the class. Imam Ghazali says, فَاسْتَظْهِرَ عَلَيْهِ بِغَايَةِ قُوَّتِكَ وَلَا يَكُبَّكَ فِي قَعْرِ جَهَنَّمِ. Struggle to gain victory over the tongue with all of your might, lest it throw you onto your face in a pit of hell. إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَتَكَلَّمُ بِالْكَلِمَةِ فَيَهْوِي بِهَا فِي جَهَنَّمَ سَبْعِينَ خَرِيفًا. He brings another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, verily a man might utter a single word, and for this one word he is hurtled to the depths of fire, a distance of 70 years. He is thrown in the fire of hell because of one statement of his. For how long? 70 years he's falling, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us, when a person is thrown in the fire of hell, he will fall in the fire for how many years before he hits the ground? 70 years, you're just going to keep falling. You know, if I pick up something and I throw it in the air, it'll fall down in a few seconds. 70 years, this person will fall until he hits the ground and every bone in his body crushes. وَقُتِلَ شَهِيدٌ فِي الْمَعْرِقَةِ فَقَالَ قَائِلٌ هَنِيئًا لَهُ الْجَنَّةِ فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ وَمَا يُرِيدَكَ وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ فَلَعَلَّهُ كَانَ يَتَكَلَّمُ فِي مَا لَا يَعْنِيهِ وَيَبْخَلُ فِي مَا لَا يُغْنِيهِ. He says that there was a person who was martyred. Again, another hadith. There was a person who was martyred in the battlefield. And the companions begin to say, oh, look how lucky he was. Look how great of a fighter he was. Look how pious of a man he was. And the Prophet ﷺ said to them that be careful of what you say about people, because that man, he could not control his tongue from backbiting. What did the Prophet ﷺ say about that person, that martyr? He said, لَعَلَّهُ كَانَ يَتَكَلَّمْ فِي مَا لَا يَعْنِيهِ. Not backbiting, sorry. This person used to talk about things that did not concern him. Unnecessary discussion he used to engage in. وَيَبْخَلُ فِي مَا لَا يُغْنِيهِ. And he was a miserly man. He was a bakhil, a conjuice insan, right? With those things which did not end up benefiting him. He was miserly, and at the same time, he spoke about things that did not benefit him. And the Prophet ﷺ stopped the companions from praising him because of these two things of his. This hadith is narrated by the Shu'b al-Iman, right? Imam Bayhaqi rahmatullahi alayhi, Shu'b al-Iman. Now moving forward, Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi alayhi, because the tongue is the most important, and he said that the tongue is the most severe part of your body, and it's so delicate that it can make it or break it for you, and make it or break it for the people around you. He says, فَحْفَظْ لِسَانَكَ مِنْ ثَمَانِيَةِ أَشْيَاءٍ. Save your tongue from how many things? ثَمَانِيَة. How many things is that? Eight things. And he goes into each of these eight things, not with too much detail, with a little bit detail. Inshallah, we'll cover this next week, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. Not next week, we're off. The week after that, inshallah, and Aziz, we'll cover this and we'll talk about this there. May Allah grant us the ability to act upon what has been said. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to use our body parts for His worship and His pleasure. And may He save us from using them for His disobedience. Subhanallah, bihamdihi, subhanakallah, bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk, wa akhiru da'wana, alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.